Good morning, gardening friends. Today is Sunday, April 7th. It's about 7:30 in the morning. And about 53 degrees. It's beautiful out today. I do like the new time. Gives us a little more sunshine to enjoy. But I'm sitting here in the back corner of my garden, having my coffee. I spent some time yesterday cleaning this area up. This is the time of the year I like to start with weeding and trimming up all of my focal points so that at least you have something to look at off in the distance. So the Statue of David area was one, and where I am sitting is the other. Because when you're walking, the way my garden is arranged, you really don't see all the focal points at once. That's purposely. I planted things to block your view, so as you turn a corner, you sort of see something and you're drawn to it, like this bench I'm sitting on, and then you sit down and lo and behold, there's a statue in front of you. But in any event, it is a beautiful day, so let's go take a walk and see what is happening. First off, back in here, I do see my white angel's trumpet. Mike could see just a little bit of green coming. I need to go ahead and put some more snail bait out there, because the slugs and snails do like to eat the fresh shoots. The other thing I noticed is my loquats are doing nicely. They will turn a bright orange color and be quite tasty. You can actually buy loquats canned in most Oriental grocery stores. They have a big hollow in the middle because that's where the seeds are. I better move this cup just a little. Otherwise, I will forget where I put it. But you can see I moved one of the cyclamen that was from the front, in front of the front door, to back here in the shade. And I moved these little potted violets. The violets volunteered themselves. There were bulbs underneath those pots, but they looked so pretty blooming that I went ahead and put them out. I trimmed up on the nandinas a little. Let me back up here so you get a little better view of this little area that I cleaned up yesterday. Ooh, I see my first hydrangea flower is coming, which is good. I did go ahead and redo this fountain. It turned out it was the fountain that was dead, and I was able to find pretty much the same one, which is unusual because all the plumbing fit. All I had to do was just basically pop the pump out and all the fittings just snapped right into the new one. The nice feature of the new one is that it has an automatic shutoff when it gets to low level, so I don't have to worry about the pump burning itself out when that water splashes its way out. And it also is a lot more powerful than the older pump. Although I think they were the same brand, they've just improved them. It's probably been about 10 years since I bought the old pump. This one, it has a dial that you can tone down in terms of how much pressure it puts out. Because when I first plugged it in, I got squirted in the face with the water coming out the top. Because it's a little stronger, it has a better flow. Let's see, looking up, I've got some new buds coming on my pindo palm. And the fern is still doing well at the top. I did clean up some of my fatsias here. As is always the case when you plant two of something, they never quite come up identical. But at least this year, height-wise, they pretty much did. This one on this side is always a little bit punier than that one. That one gets a little more sun. And I did have to water yesterday thoroughly for really the first time this year. I did identify here, I'm going to cut out a big bunch of this monkey grass. I do have some places where I wanted to expand the monkey grass or extend it. Wasn't certain of where to take it. Now at least I've identified where to take it from. Blueberries, you can see, are making. These are in the sun, so they are turning blue a little sooner. I did buy netting that I got last year for the figs, so I'll be able to net them to keep the birds away. Here you can see my pecan that seeded itself last year is coming up. And the cuttings I took from Sarah's pink angel's trumpet. I took two cuttings, they both lived. And I just grouped them together to make a healthier clump. So that one is going to be pink. And this one, which is doing really well, is orange. Usually I found, at least in zone 9A, if you can keep them in the same spot for a couple of years, the roots will establish and they'll come back reliably after frosts. Versus if you just got it this year, it's not certain that it's going to come back. So I always take cuttings. Cuttings are ridiculously simple to take though, so you just basically cut about a foot long section, stick it in water, and as soon as you see roots appear, which will be about a week and a half, put it in some dirt. And nine times out of 10, it will root. Bottle brush is still doing spectacularly well. I just can't get over how full that is. This is the first full year it's been exposed to sun. Those of you that have been with me for a while realize that stump used to be a loquat tree. And the bottle brush likes sun. It was planted before the loquat tree was, but it's relishing the sunlight it gets now. I did buy some flowers for these. I don't want to show the sun, but I have hooks along the fence. And I went to Lowe's. Actually, I went all over looking for potted plants, and they are expensive this year. So since I had the hanging pots, I just went and bought some vinca. I'll show you later when we get to the front porch. So for less than $2, I got three vincas that I'm going to put in each pot. And here is my Trecleospermum jasminoides. It's just starting to bloom. This is when it's at its absolutely fabulous stage, because it doesn't knock you in the face yet. You can smell that scent all the way at the house, at the deck. Now, I just weeded all of this a week ago, so it looks like I have to come back in here and weed again, as is always the case. The lavenders are still living. Back in here, I didn't do a lot yet this week. Oh, I do see some Japanese fern entwining itself around my pindo. I do have to get that out because that has a very fine branching structure, the stems, and they will girdle things. They when they die, they get like wires. So you have to be careful you don't let them encircle anything that's important to you. The agave is looking spectacular. I do have to fertilize it. I never put crocks in the bottom of that urn, so I am certain after 7 or 8 years in this spot that it has rooted in the ground, especially since it has that lush top. Back in here, all is well. You can see the holly is pushing up growth like crazy. I'm going to trim back some of the top growth. When you have an established shrub, you're probably sick of hearing me say this, but if you do decide to cut them back dramatically, also called coppicing, you can, well, I cut them back to about a foot below where I want the ultimate size of the shrub to be. That gives me some space for these branches to grow at the top. So, in other words, this is about as tall as I want it to get, at least initially. And the advantage of cutting back an old shrub, that's been in this spot for longer than I've been in this house, and I've been in the house for 30 years, it's got roots that go down to God knows where, but you don't have to ever water it. You know, it takes care of itself, and those roots are pumping all kinds of nourishment up to the stems here, so it will recover quite quickly, and you don't have to fuss with it during summers. Well, this is a pretty view just looking through here with the sun shining on everything. The yellow jasmine are not in bloom anymore. They did their thing earlier in the winter. Sunlight looks fantastic, and the dew. Oh, look at that. The dew is still on the roses. Nice lemony smell coming from this one. Only the newest ones tend to have the scent. And the spiderwort, which for us is a weed, I just let it, it seems to want to grow in this spot, and I like to let it grow there. Once when it's done blooming, I will cut it back. But it looks kind of pretty right now. I love the flowers, and so do the bees. And of course, that's spiderwort down there as well. This rose is more in the shade, but it is absolutely full of bud. I remember reading an old flowering gardening book. They'd say, pregnant with blossom. I guess that's a politically incorrect term to use now. Oh well. Here are some of the haul that I had last week from Aldi's. These are the Asiatic lilies. They never bloomed, which is why they probably didn't sell all that well. And I'm not certain they're going to bloom here because they were shocked upon planting. But they should come back, and all the leftover fertilizer from the palm, which, let's go up there, look at the sun shining on that inflorescence. It's absolutely beautiful today. But all the fertilizer I use on that should help keep the lilies healthy. I noticed one of my ligularias back here, the little one, is suffering a little. Maybe it's not getting enough sunlight. Back in here, I can't get over how nicely these toad lilies have done. Those were bare root last year, and they have just really, really spread. This one as well. This is an amaryllis bloom, so not to be confused with the toad lily. I always have to think when I say toad lily because I want to say trout lily, but that's a totally different thing. You can see my bananas are starting to come back. They're rising from the aspidistra. This was another cutting I took of the Iachroma. Just planted it out. I had put the Iachromas out by the garage outside, so they got a little bit of sun and they burned a little. But it should do well there. And it will, being up close and in my face, it'll make the little, almost insignificant blue blossoms a little more apparent. Still haven't figured out what to do with the Datura. These are the Vincas I'm going to put in the hanging pots. I thought they were a pretty color. It'll take a while for the pot to fill out, but I'm in no rush. My hosta is doing really well. That hosta's been in that pot now for, let's just say, 5 years plus. And it does really well. I fertilize every now and then with a slow release fertilizer. My mints are doing well. This is the mint from New York that I've called Sophie's Mint. And the other mint is chocolate mint. My roses, these are Oklahomas, are setting out buds, and looks like one is going to open this week. I do have to get in there and weed at some point, but right now I'm just enjoying the roses. I decided to free up my table, so I took all the non-sprouted Caladium bulbs and set them back here on the floor. I was reluctant to do that earlier in the year because, annoyingly, raccoons like to come and dig up the corms. They don't eat them. They just throw them on the ground, but they're kind of interested to see what's in the pots. So after having them on the tabletop for, what, about 4 weeks now, I just got sick of looking at them, so I put them down there. I did find out, because normally I don't start them this early in the season, they're not going to really do anything until the temperatures get reliably above 60. And at least that's what I've read. And so if I had bottom heat, they probably would have sprouted by now. But I'm in no rush. They're still there, and they will sprout. My papyrus is sending out a lot of new growth. Of course, that's new papyrus from this year. I can't take any credit from wintering it over. But it was pretty and fairly inexpensive. I think I paid about $12 a pot for that. My sempervivums are still plump. These big ones are kind of hard to water unless you water from behind. But I do have a syringe that I use to water them. It looks like my horsetail, Equisetum, is sending up new shoots at the bottom. It looks like it had some little flowers. Hadn't really noticed before. More violets. I did have violets earlier in the season. Again, they all seeded themselves. How they got in the pots, I don't know. I didn't put them there. It's kind of nice here to look and just see the different greens. You've got the green of the ivy, which I'm going to have to trim off the house. It'll swallow up this house if I'm not careful. And the lighter green of the Virginia creeper. Virginia creeper is another weed in this area. I tend to grow a lot of things that people consider weeds. I don't care, they're pretty, and it's best time is in the fall when it turns a nice red. And I cleaned up my pitcher plants, my Sarracenias. This is an unnamed variety, but it looks a lot better now that I've cleaned it up. I don't ever turn my Sarracenias. It lives in that pot, on that table, in that spot, facing this direction. If I move the table or do whatever, I make sure I always put it back the way it was facing. Because I am assuming that they face their pitchers a certain way in relationship to the sun, since they all tend to face in the same direction. Now this is Scarlet Bell. It blooms quite reliably, and it always has two blooms every year. I cleaned up some of the bigger flowers on it. This is a hybrid, and to be truthful, I don't think I've ever seen it catch a fly, because the top of it is always kind of either closed or nearly closed, versus this one has an open and obvious pitcher. I imagine when they hybridized it, they made it kind of rely more upon man, as opposed to just taking care of itself. Here's some more cuttings that I had taken. These are the better of the four coleus cuttings I took. I cut them back. They got burned badly. Of course, I took the cuttings in a vase back in December, and they lived for a couple of months in that vase, in my kitchen, in the darkness, and decided to pot them up because they had rooted, of course, in the water, and they took. And unfortunately, when I put them outside, which is what I was doing it for, was to get them used to the sun gradually, it wasn't quite gradual enough, and they burned. But pinch them back, they'll come back. This was my species amaryllis. Oh, I see I have to empty some of the water from this. Whatever it is, I can't think of it fast enough, but I've watered it too much. My Nepenthes bromeliad, couldn't think of it fast enough. This had a beautiful pink blossom on it last year. I think I paid like $30 for it, which is more than I like to pay for any one plant. But it had two little pups on it, and the pups are doing quite well. But I do see I need to punch a hole in the bottom of that pot. It'll probably rot if I don't. My Nepenthes is still doing well, as is the strawberry begonia. That pot held a strawberry begonia prior to the Nepenthes a couple of years ago, and I've been fighting it ever since. You can see my crepe myrtles are sprouting out at the tops and all over elsewhere. When you pollard them like that, they send out a big tuft of branches, and I'll have to go up there. Well, I don't have to. I choose to go up there and thin them out. Otherwise, they'll just be too thick, and there'll be all kinds of fungal diseases that can take over your crepe myrtle. Back in here, didn't do a lot. Around these boxwoods is where those caladiums are ultimately going to go. I have four amaryllis in each direction, north, south, east, and west. Only two are blooming. The blue pansies have done really well. And the daylilies are coming. In fact, I see some flower stalks already. For some reason, these two daylilies on this end are slower than the ones on that end. Go figure. I cleaned this area up, and I threw out my old fern that I didn't protect. It was a Kimberley fern. And when I saw the price of the new Kimberley ferns, I said, you know, I have a bunch of Kimberley ferns in the front yard. Let me put some fresh potting soil there and just transplant some of those. So that's what I did. Looks pitiful right now, but it'll grow. Godot's water dish is still there. He hasn't come back yet, but will. My bougainvillea is doing well. You can see why this one is a little bit faster to bloom, because it gets the morning sun, as witnessed by the morning sun on it, versus the one on that side doesn't have any flowers yet. That is the curse of a formal garden. If you like to have the same plant on both sides, it takes a little bit of planning to find something that does well on both sides, basically in different exposures, and boxwoods are one of those plants. And the bougainvillea will do better once when the sun changes its position in the sky. I don't see any bees yet, but they are out here, and you can see little teeny tiny oranges, satsumas, forming. And these two Easter lilies were here from last year. And these are the two. I bought them as singles from Aldi's last week. So I planted one there and two in a cluster over there. And here's another Easter lily from last year. So I kind of have a trail of Easter lilies. So it starts out with the Lenten roses, and then the ground ginger blooms, and then the Easter lilies. And the last thing to bloom will be these foxgloves. The foxgloves I have to plant every year. They don't come back. My mandevilla is full of bud. Of course, this wandering dude has come back. Tradescantia, spiderwort, a rose by any other name. Still have a blossom or two left on my lily of the valley bush. Have to change hands here while I open the gate. Have to work this garden over a little, but it's looking very lush and green. My toad lilies have taken. If I can just get them to rise above the ivy, they'll do well. Now this Satsuma bloomed the earliest of all of them. And you can see, again, the little fruits coming. My little topiaries are doing well. You have to ignore the construction going on next door. It is what it is. It'll be beautiful eventually. These are some encore azaleas I got last year, and I'll have to look the name up because they're not my autumn carnation that I usually get, but their selling feature was the fact they were only $3. They were marked way down. And you can see the chunk that was taken out of this particular lavender is being regrown. This, I've told most people, know it's oregano. I planted it about 5 years ago and it has just spread, and I let it. It is quite tasty, oregano. It seems to like to creep along the ground. My Australian tree fern is still unfurling new fronds. It looks like a tree fern again. And lo and behold, my bags of leaves have multiplied. I'll have to distribute them again. My Philadelphia's is still in bloom. Muck orange. I think it's also called, what, English dogwood? Oh, I got a snapdragon in bloom. Didn't notice that yesterday. Amaryllis are blooming in the front yard. For some reason this year they've come up speckled. But it is what it is. They're still beautiful. And I've got my two pots of pelargoniums out on the steps. Here's some more amaryllis coming. I weeded this out good yesterday. Had a lot of oxalis. I am tempted to put that datura back there in the corner about where that fern is. It can share the spot with the fern. Over here, I did plant all the seeds out in the garden. I did tell y'all I'm not going to bother with tomatoes this year. So what I'm trying is I put the cucumbers in the two far corners of the bed, and I'm going to try and train them up on the fence. Lemon balm, parsley, bunch onions, nothing. Something will happen there. Here's where I put my seeded Swiss chard. Will remain to see if it lives or not. Of course, my dill. Had an interesting thing yesterday. There was a beautiful strawberry there, and when I grabbed the strawberry without my glasses, I got a little bit of dill and mixed in with it. Dill and strawberry, not a pretty flavor. But the strawberry was good. The butterfly bushes have pretty much caught up to each other. Here's where I planted my borage.
And of course, back there is the other cucumber.
Where the other cucumber is, it's not coming up yet, but that's where I planted my ginger. This is starting to look good. The snapdragons, or antirrhinums, are coming. The yellow pansies are just really doing fantastic right now. Oh, a weed.
Weeds can be deceptive because they grow in stuff that's not a weed.
It makes you think that they're the real plant as opposed to a weed. Back in here, you can see the purple crepe myrtle is doing well. And here's where I put my hall of hyacinths. I just planted them as they grew in the pots and just stuck them in the ground. And some of them will come back. Pretty much all of them should come back next year. And I'm leaving the spent flowers on for now because this is a garden that I only see from a distance. And that's one of those keys to keep in mind, that even a spent flower looks good from a distance. Oh, I see a flower coming on one of my lilies. This one doesn't bloom all that much. That one I dug up from the side of a road. It was growing as a weed, but someone had originally planted it. I can't think of the name of the lily off the top of my head, so I will put it in the comment section. But it's related to the milk and wine lilies.
This is the only plant that may not make it through may not have made it through the winter. And that was that yellow, what's it called? Well, there's the tag. Doesn't do me much good. To cassia.
Don't need the tag, I remembered it. And I'm not so certain I'm gonna keep this hydrangea for another year, but to tell you the truth, it ticks me off, because when I go to weed around it, I'm always breaking a branch off. It is the most fragile plant that I think I've ever had. And it just annoys the heck out of me that I can't work next to it, because we're always snapping branches off of it. In here, oh, everything's looking good. I dug up, I salvaged some plants from the potager. I had some, the pink coneflowers that came up. And these other things are 4 o'clocks. They were all wilted yesterday, probably will wilt again later today. And I took the cutting off the bottom of the fig tree and I have it rooting. I originally tossed it in the trash because I figured I don't have room for another fig. And then I thought later in the day and went and grabbed it, and I figured I'm gonna try rooting it anyway. I've never rooted a fig, but it's in water in my kitchen. The same spot where the coleus was. Here's some amaryllis coming. The one thing that has really sent up a lot of shoots is this arborvitae fern, now that it has a lot more sunlight. But that'll be taken away when the cycad flower opens. Oh, I've got flowers not opened yet. But my Louisiana iris is coming. I'll do the short when it does blossom, because irises usually only last a day. But I was surprised that this year it's the most flowers it's ever sent out. Let's see, there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 7 flowers in one clump. And then this side, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 flowers. So y'all know me well enough by now. If they do well in a spot, leave them be. So this is kind of where I grow my irises. So I've got the Louisiana irises. I've got creeping irises. They do okay. Here are my creeping irises, but they get hit by frost every year. And the flowers are not that spectacular. They can be blooming in front of you and you might walk right by them and not see them, but they still are an iris and they are pretty. My bearded iris are all doing well, even the ones that I just got this year. This garden's not going to do an awful lot for the summer because it's my camellia garden. And camellias are kind of done for the season. Ooh, look at the loquats again. Lots of loquats. And low-hanging ones, too. That's always nice. More wild spiderwort. There's always one clump that comes up here. Let me take that back. There's always two clumps that come here. And I let them bloom and then snap them off. But there you have it for the day. A lot is happening. More loquats. They are just all over the place. My magnolia has buds, but I don't see any flowers yet. It'll be the next couple of weeks. So there you have it for today. I hope you all get out and enjoy the sunshine this week, if it's sunny where you are. I don't think I've shown you that crepe myrtle in a while. We did clean some of that up. But I hope you can all get out in your gardens this week. And take care. Till next time.